us until the very end of this session. We have Mr. Mike Zafirovski.
Soccer, I had the privilege of being number 10, but I'll make sure that next time I'm speaking, I'll not be number 10 in the roster of speakers. But boy, I'm so motivated at what I heard. Great stories, I'll try not to repeat much of it. I'm here as a proud Macedonian, as a proud American to say I'm delighted to be home back in Skopje. It's always great to be able to climb up to Vodno for inspiration. And it was great to be here. I could not help myself just make a few very quick observations of the speakers. The first one, Ichak, made wonderful comments how we need to think about ourselves. But what I would think a pretty strong exception is that we need to be looking at people from the outside for inspiration. I mean, of course, Steve Jobs, many people, including people in this room, they're from overseas. Wonderful to be looking at best practices. There's so many best practices within Macedonia. Every time I come here, whether it's businesses, professors, I mean, in this presentation, I mean, that can be a best practice at Stanford University, in Moscow, in China, any place. Although one thing he did say is that sort of a jealousy. Yeah, they stole the company from the government, or somehow she knew somebody, or somebody helped her unfairly. And that's a cancer which we need to eliminate in this country. I spent 25 years at General Electric. Many people say it was the best company ever. And you would not believe how much time we spent looking at who's doing things better than us. And there was a passion, there was a desire. You're not looking who's doing things better. Then you just say, well, they're German, they're Japanese, or whatever reason, they went to a great school. But how are they doing it? And can I take that practice and bring it to my company? And if I ask half of you, I'll become best friends with Nina. Say, Nina, how the hell have you accomplished all those things? Can you come and speak with my people? Can I buy a cup of coffee and learn? And yes, I'm sure she's not perfect, none of us are. But as opposed to looking at things that maybe she's not perfect at, I would focus 100% on things that make her successful. Find other mentors or sponsors, as someone had said. But the whole concept of best practices is embedded in people that are successful. Not always looking to become more successful in the future. Jim, your comment on 1882, not a surprise at all. I mean, it breaks my heart. I'm a father of three sons, grandfather now of a 4 and a half month old boy, mentor many people, been in 120 countries, and it's very, very actually frustrating to see the mentality of we cannot accomplish something, somehow the world is stacked against me. It's not easy to move from one quarter to another. Someone may have more possibilities from backgrounds, whatever. But there are ways to really move forward. Read Jim's books. He said he only had 10 minutes, he has 2 hours. He'll be able to convince you, or not convince you, but to provide much better context of how you can move forward. But it's a real issue, but it's also an opportunity for the world, and very specifically for Macedonia. Failures, I mean, I'll just use another GE example. The most common word within GE was, we would hate to see how the second best company in the world does things. So even if you're most successful, now I'll talk for 5 minutes with successes and 55 minutes in 1 hour presentation, and all of these are broken. Not because we want to be masochists and punish ourselves, but view how can we deal with the problems. So what do you mean if you're successful, you should acknowledge things are not going well. If you have failed, and it's the best example of to look at yourself, why did you fail? Failing once is not a problem. If you fail twice with the same issue, then shame on you. And Silicon Valley is so successful because there's a culture of embracing and celebrating failure. More than any other place in the world. So again, the most successful place in the world for innovation. They actually embrace failure. Not because you have repeated it over and over again, but you have gone through the challenges, you have scars, and you've had, have driven that. And last, Sonia, you'd be happy to hear we have a fantastic CEO from Macedonia 2025, Biljana Markovic, and most of her staff is female as well, so actually we're looking great talent to develop the program. My talk initially was supposed to be 20 minutes. I'll cut it a little bit shorter, not to repeat things, but I thought, just to make a couple comments, I love three things here. Young professionals. I mean, there's the future to any country, very specifically Macedonia included. Sustainable growth. I mean, just think of your favorite plant. Flower, or it can be a tree. They need nurturing, sun, water, clean air. And I think to be able to get sustainable growth as a person, as a company, you need to determine yourself what's going to take to produce this sustainable growth. And the last one, personal well-being. I mean, I would argue that's the success, that's the key to successful life. If you do not feel a sense of a personal well-being, and you can hide it, you can look for shortcuts, you can pretend, you put different clothes on, you can put a fake smile. When you go to bed, you know whether you have a good feeling about yourself or not. And hopefully the next 10, 15 minutes will provide some sort of a context, at least the way I think about challenges and problems. One thing which I'll say over and over again, write it down. What is your goals, whatever that's supposedly what you stand for, and have a way to reflect. Do you really do things consistent with your purported objectives? A very quick background, I was born probably 1 kilometer from here, Debrecen, Broadway. My goal was, as a youngster in the then old Yugoslavia, we thought we knew everything. Not in a negative way, but we're pretty politically aligned, and whether we did not like the Warsaw Pact or the West, there was a view of it, the non-aligned movement was the best. My goals in life were to be a great soccer player, to keep envisioning winning the winning goal for Yugoslavia in a World Cup, or to become a politician. I believe a 20-time politician was a noble profession. And I thought I was doing reasonably well, especially my class, few of my classmates from first to eighth grade are back in the back of the room. So I thought I was doing reasonably well, maybe delusional as a youngster. At age 15, the world turned upside down. My parents decided to move to the United States. We thought we loved it here. So actually, they're both age 56 and 57, quite elderly to have my mom was 41 when she had me, I'm oldest of two. So with $1,500 and no other belongings, they never learned to speak English, they both worked in factories, we picked up our bags and went to the United States. So the world started, the life started all over again. I spent 25 fantastic years at General Electric. Very fortunate to have had the privilege of leading people for most of my career. My first CEO job at GE was when I was 31, when I least expected. So he tapped me on my shoulder and says, Mike, I'd like for you to be, you bought some of those companies, we'd like for you to be the CEO. I was CEO of 5 different GE businesses, president of Motorola, CEO of Nortel, and now chair of 3 Blackstone companies. I'm 62 years old, and I think this is probably another 25 to 30 years of hopefully a very productive life, which I will have ahead of me. But back to the well-being, it starts with yourself. And I say you really have to manage and motivate yourself. That provides some context. But if you're happy with yourself, again, nothing else will be able to replace it. And my very good friend, the former CEO of Baxter, now the most popular professor at Kellogg, Eric Kramer, will be speaking here on Friday. I mean, all he talks about is values-based leadership, but one of the comments he makes is if something is truly important to you, like you say, I really want to accomplish A, B, or C, it's much easier to be 100% committed and never to fail. Then 98% and 95% just becomes a slippery slope. I'll give you a couple examples. I mean, from real life, if you're going to quit smoking, if you've quit for a couple weeks, a couple months, if you have one cigarette before you know, you're bad smoking. I mean, I quit smoking 8 times. Last time I quit was October 1st, 1996. I still miss it. But I know if I have one cigarette, I'm going backwards. If you say they would cheat or steal, either one time, either get caught, or well, maybe I'll do it again. If you're married, you cheat with your husband or wife, you do it one time, and before you know, it becomes a disease. If you say customers are more important to you, do you allow your customers to fail? If you can help. And even if you do everything possible to recover. If you say performance management is important and you provide your employees with a fair assessment, if you sometimes forget to do it, or do you tell them a lie? So you're doing great, you don't provide bad feedback, and somehow you think you're doing a service. So you can take all those things, if you will, and I'll go to the my playbook, if you will, of how to really give yourself the best chance of succeeding. None of us are going to be 100% successful, and those things will not apply to all of you. You can put a different thing, but this is 2 o'clock this morning. I was preparing this page. What can I tell 200-300 professionals? They want to improve themselves. What will be a playbook for you to follow? First of all, your foundation, for you to write down some statements. So if you become a manager or a leader, for you to stand in front of people to say, this is what's important to me, you can always, always count for me to behave this way. And if you're brave enough to put down some of your personal goals, and actually I'll be brave to show some of those. If you're running a business, strategy is very important. And typically, you want to be different. Either a different strategy than competition, or doing the same things differently. If you're like everybody else, most likely will not be successful. If you're in business, to be able to deliver on your promises is critical. And there's so many wonderful books. Personally, my favorite is Peter Drucker. And one of the best writers of management leadership. And you can read that he says, and that again, strategy without execution is lunacy. You talk, you make nice presentations, but people are going to know if you're truly committed to make the strategy into reality. So first, what needs to be done? What's right for the enterprise? And what's always very important for me is to always put the company first, or the organization, or the team first. It's amazing how successful you're going to be if you're not selfish. Are you doing something which is good for the organization or for yourself? Develop an action plan, take responsibility if you're a leader, and then simply follow up over and over again. Communicate, walk the talk. The main reason for communication is to get buy-in. I would say just as important is if you make a communication, you make a commitment. And it's always easier to attain goals if you have more than one person knowing what those commitments are. And last and certainly not least, to be able to have a reflection. And actually, I do mine on a daily basis. Came from a young gentleman from South Africa, Nicholas Johnson. I'm going to share that with you in just 1 minute. Now, of course, environment is very important. Can you hear me in the back? I for a minute do not want to underestimate the impact of positive environment, whether it's the country, the company, and what I think takes, it's magical, if you can have it in an organization, 4 major elements. 1, high expectations. I mean, people get inspired. Companies have high expectations and also really, really specified expectations for high values. In dealing with consequences, people who do not deliver, who do not have the values, that those people do not belong in these organizations. Equally important is a real commitment to people development and a sense of a meritocracy. Not only if you know somebody, you put those 4 things together, and I do believe magic happens. If you're owner of a business, that may be a good question for you. Do you believe your company has those 4 attributes? What I'm also going to say is that even if you do not have, if you're not lucky to be in the right environment, it is very possible for you to, change the dynamics. And I will discuss my first CEO job back in October 1, 1986. I was given a 30-day advance notice that I'll become a CEO, and I was going to speak with a group of 400 people. So you're 31, 32 years old, I said, what am I tell those individuals? What they can count on me? And this is the page which I probably have used 500 times since then. This you can count, and we will put everything to be able to be the best provider of products and services to our customers. I spent half of my time with the salespeople and the customers. Never fails. 30 plus years. Second, very important at that point in time, is that we're gonna make sure there's a performance culture, there's an appraisal process, there's a feedback, and I'm gonna take it very personally for the people that wanna get promoted, and they, for them to know they have the values and the results, and be able to attain their career objectives. Third, superior financial results. Now, most places, if you say, we are the most profitable company in the world, they will not get the hearts racing for your employees. But at the same time, if you make the commitments, especially General Electric, I was very honest, like, unless we're successful financially, somebody else will be my place. But I can assure you, I will never deviate pursuing financial results at the expense of customers or employees. And I was very convinced that 1 + 2 = 3. And again, in 30 plus years, we always behaved that way. Even back at that time, I thought giving back to the community is very important. If you're privileged enough to have the means, you should be able to provide, whether that's internship opportunities to give back to the communities. Competing and winning was always very successful, was always very important. And also, if you have committed values that supposedly are desired in your company, you actually walk the talk. Do you make promotions? Do you reward people? Do you ask people to leave the company? They're not acting with those values. So again, forget this page, if you will. If you're an employee, if you're a manager, if you're a supervisor, do you think your employees would know what's important to you? So again, back to Jim's comment, 18 and 82. I would say most of the people that are successful have a very clear goal, they have very clear definitions of what they want. If you get other people to follow, this is a wonderful way to provide that, provide information, to be asking for feedback. Next one is a bit more. I've shared that page with many times with people, but this is the one on the personal side. This is the first time I've shared this with outside. And those are general themes. They change from time to time. And I probably have 2 or 3 items of each and every one of those. First one, I'll do my best to live a meaningful, happy, and healthy life. This seems pretty generic. How can you argue with that? But even back to the days of Aristotle, people say you become what you think. And you become what you do. So what you think and what you do repetitively, sometimes by habit, becomes in essence who you are. Now, if you're not happy where you are, actually, that's great news, because you can change how you think, and you can change what you do. So you can say, choose to live a purposeful, meaningful life, and you put down, what do you want to accomplish this year? What do you want to accomplish next week? So that is a very powerful way that you do, and you become what you think, and you become what you do. And it's within the power of each one of us to be able to drive those. Very appreciative of blessings in our life. I think I have many strengths. I can list probably 50, but I can probably list 50 things I wish were different. When I was playing soccer, I wish I was faster. I was very skilled, but I was not very fast. My father used to have a stuttering problem. I'm not as bad as he was, but certainly there was a way to say, look, I wish I had a radio voice or TV voice. So I can list many issues, but I don't spend a second thinking about those issues to improve them, but you focus on your strengths, and you move forward. And it's amazing how you can go from the fishbowl, from one bowl to the other, if you focus on things that work well and play to your strengths. Our family always comes first. I mean, 3 sons, ages 25, 20, 28, 30, wife of 33 years. I do not think we'll ever disagree with any actions you provided. Second, I'm very supportive of the people and organizations I'm associated with. And whether that's Macedonia, every school I've been to, my friends during the back of this room here, with the view of not to ever look for expedience, provide such a wonderful support for the concept of well-being. Again, you have no one to answer but yourself. So if you never forget your friends, regardless of what you do today, or your schools, or your friends, and always when you leave a room, ask yourself, was the, your participation there a downer, energy sapper, or as a result of your impact there, was a positive force multiplier? Increasingly philanthropic, we've done well as a family, so increasingly becoming more philanthropic. And again, I have a number of areas where we'll be actually, what is the public schools in Chicago, which in many ways are 10 times worse than public schools in Macedonia, health clinics, and I'll reflect and reprioritize on an ongoing basis. So again, this is my chart. Question for you, do you have a chart for yourself? And do you measure? And this is the quote. I mean, I've heard it 12 years ago. People ask, Mike, what motivates you? I mean, I can spend years and decades thinking meaning of life. I saw this quote and captured my heart. Unfortunately, this boy had AIDS. He died 4 years afterwards, but this is what he made the AIDS conference in German South Africa back in 2001. And do all you can with what you have and the time you have and the place you are. I have this post-it, my bathroom windows every morning when I wake up, brush my teeth every night before I go to bed, brush my teeth, I look at it. It's in the office. And again, you don't have to answer to anyone. If I ever had a perfect day, no. And I think it's ever good below 50%. It gives you a chance to reflect daily. So what are your commitments? Are you happy with them? If not, how do you move it forward? So back to the whole concept of this, I was not talking Ironman. When the concept of well-being is the view to hopefully relate to you that if you have well-being, you have to define what's important to you. Not say because it's politically correct or because your girlfriend or boyfriend or husband may be impressed. But do you really believe it? Write it down and start acting for it. I have two other pages, but I don't think I'll spend more than just a second. This is more on mentoring in your career. You're going to be blessed with a wonderful career to this point in time. But I've always been out in my career. Always took the hardest jobs. I even went first with the United States, selling encyclopedias. And a person spoke zero English. I mean, one summer, I knocked on probably 5,000 doors. I sold 2 sets of encyclopedias in 70 days. What a great learning experience. I spent the summers working in factories. Most of my friends went vacationing, but they gave you the idea, the dignity of the work. Many people do work in manual jobs. I was very good at it. I knew I did not want to work in a factory as a profession, but I always was able to find a job, even if it's a low-level job, what can you learn, and for you to excel, to be able to get the next job. I'll pick, have the results speak for themselves. I mean, I'll give you an advice, if you spend your time complaining to people, how you're the best person, to Steve Jobs, or Gates, or whomever is your hero, and somehow your results are not being recognized, I mean, I'll ask you to think twice. Is it maybe you have the inflated view of your results? I can tell you, I mean, all over the world, Macedonia included, there's such a demand for people that can actually deliver results. You could be very unfortunate, or one of the few that actually does great results, you're not being recognized, maybe you should look to another company to work at. But I've always put the pressure on myself. I have higher expectations of myself than anyone else. And if you do the best you can to get to the results, I'm still confident maybe a little bit old school, the results will be recognized even in places like Macedonia, developing countries. And I'm sure Nina is dying to hire overachievers that are not being recognized in their companies. There's many Ninas, not as many as we need. There's many Ninas, you can hear from Igor Popovsky, what he's doing with General Electric. I mean, I don't want to start naming names, so I'm going to take the rest of the night. To mentor and also become a mentee. I mean, I probably have 40 mentees today. I've been mentoring since age 25, I also have mentors. It's amazing when people start asking you questions. How, why? In the process, you providing feedback back to the individuals, how much you grow as part of the process. Last, I'll give it to you all, and if you do, you'll have very few regrets. And some of my challenges were some encyclopedias, or at what Nortel and I knew at the end. We did, I mean, we took all the actions, but we thought of people for the right reason, and there's never any regrets. How to grow your business, I'll skip it, and get back to the first page. This is not a how-to for yourself. And this is a great reminder for me, the companies I chair today, starting with give a personal foundation. What's important to you, and if it is, what are your goals currently, and how are you doing this? If you're a manager, can you explain your management style? Do you like it? Do you ever get feedback from your employees? Do you have a strategy how you be successful? If you don't have one, I mean, you may end up with a strategy showing you to, which is nowhere. Do you have a history of accomplishments? If not, I mean, you can read many books, but this is a pretty good quote from the best management guru I would argue of all time. If not this one, take another one. Communicate to us. If you're going to quit smoking, you're going to tell me, like, I'm going to quit smoking. So people are going to come and smell under your door. Is Mike breaking his pledge? Same thing is true for your business goals, for your ambitions, for your business targets. The last one, self-evaluation. I'm extreme, doing it daily 4 or 5 times, but how do you reflect? And again, I would propose to this group, great to see this many people on a weeknight, interested in your careers. If you find a process to manage and discipline yourself, you'll be a much more inspired person for yourself. And if you feel good about yourself, people around you will be much happier to have you around, your companies will be much more successful. And hopefully, at least in Macedonia, we'll go from 18% to at least 50%, and then maybe we can look for a bigger number after that. So, thank you for being here. It's always great to be here.
Thank you, everyone, for staying here with us. We are sorry for prolonging the session. The speakers were too interesting, and I didn't want to cut them and cut their speeches, so I hope you understand this. If you like the session, we're going to repeat it again. So Macedonia 2025 is a platform for sharing knowledge and best practices. Tonight in Skopje have brought in one place the best practices from the world. So thank you, speakers, for sharing your knowledge, and thank you, participants, for participating.
Yeah, thank you.